Hello and welcome. I hope everybody is having a fantastic day. If you're on this soon, you're probably replaying, so give me a hashtag replay in the comments. Usually it takes a little bit for people to get started. It is Tuesday. We've made it through the first day of the week. And yesterday, most of us probably started applying for the SBA information out there, so I hope that's going well for you. I hope that you're having a beautiful day. Hop on and say hello as you pop in so I know who's watching. And I do apologize if my comments start coming in late. I do try to reply to you guys. It is really windy out here in Northern Nevada, so hopefully my comments will come in real time. It drives me nuts when I play back these recordings and I see a bunch of comments that I've missed because my phone just isn't keeping up. So today we're going to be talking about your company's culture. But before that, I'm just going to recap yesterday a little bit about what we talked about. Yesterday we talked about the pillars to success and really just those foundational pieces that if you want your center to sustain this economic downturn, the things that you're going to have to put in place in order to be a sustainable business. And you guys, I want to just point out that this is just like a big puzzle, right? And these pieces that I'm giving you this week are just pieces of that puzzle. And if you really master each piece of this, you're going to make it. You know, it's really just standing out of the crowd. Each one of these pieces are basically things that when you put them into place, you're really going to up the quality of your program, which in turn will draw more people to you. Okay, so when push comes to shove, it's all about finances, right? And this is something I really, really struggled with when I was a new owner. Actually, probably the first 5 years of ownership, I really struggled with this concept that what it really comes down to is our success is it's financial. And as directors, that's really hard for us to hear. And, you know, I came from a director's mindset when I was an owner, and it took me a little bit to break free of that mindset, right? But it is vital that you start thinking like a director, or I mean like an owner and a director. We need both to be successful. But the reason is because without those strong financial foundation pieces, right, without really prioritizing that, you can't pay your staff, you can't pay your rent, you can't afford to stay in business. So as taboo as it is in this field, we have to prioritize financials, right? If you're going to last, if you're going to be sustainable, we have to prioritize financials. And all of this is really going to help you learn how to do that. I'm not going into any like actual financial foundations. You guys know that I have my business consultant that helps me with that portion. But what this is going to help you to do is these foundational pieces that I'm giving you will ensure so that you will be the first choice when parents are looking for childcare. It will ensure that parents are willing to pay for what you're serving them with, right? You're going to prioritize yourself so that they pay you first. A lesson my husband taught me, and my husband comes from corporate management, and so his thought process was very different than mine. And a lesson that he taught me early on was that we need to make sure that parents prioritize our bill and pay us first, right? He would tell me that we need to make sure that they make us a priority, because what happens is they were putting me off, right? I was not a priority. They weren't afraid to lose their child's spot. So he taught me that you've got to send the message that if you need to go to work, you need childcare. And if you need childcare, you better pay me first, so that we are not constantly the one that everybody's putting the bill off on, right? During Black Friday every year. I just used to dread when I was like my first 5 years in business, I dreaded that time because I knew the week after Black Friday, parents weren't going to have the money to pay me. So that lesson really taught me to be more aggressive. I started sending messages out the week before Black Friday, telling them like, look, I understand Black Friday's coming and you're going to spend a lot of money, but your payment is still due the Monday after you get back. So these foundational pieces are things that I'm going to give you that are going to make it so that you're going to create urgency in parents and others, and so that they will prioritize you, so that they will choose you, your payment first. They'll be so scared to lose their spot with you that they will make you a priority, which is a big reason why even my parents that can't afford to pay my full payment, and even though you guys know I have a hardship form I created, I do let them apply for hardship right now. A lot of them are still coming back and offering to pay something. Even if they can't pay 100% of the tuition, if they've lost, like I've got a few families where both the husband and wife have lost their job, or a single mom is being laid off, they're still figuring out what can I pay, because they are so scared of losing their spot at my center. And that is achievable for you guys. I used to be in a place where I always had only about 80% enrollment, right? But then I got to this place where now I have a 200 child wait list. And that's really just these pieces. Once these pieces were put into place, that is where I was able to achieve this. So yesterday we talked about your center's value. That was the pillar that we touched on yesterday, or your vision. I'm sorry. It's your vision, right? Your vision is that foundational piece to build your value. And it is one of the most important things, because it's going to help you with your staff buy-in, your parents buy-in. It's going to give you a mission too. So during times like this, where you just want to quit, it's going to keep you going. It also will get you to that next level of excellence. It'll get you to a place where you start recognizing and seeing areas that you may not be performing as well as you would like to. And it will really help you get to that next level and make your center a center of excellence. So I hope you guys did the homework I gave you in the workbook, and I hope you have the workbook. If you don't have the workbook, make sure you put it in the comments. I'll tell you, it is kind of difficult for us to go through the comments and figure out who got it and who didn't after the videos. So one of the things I'm going to be doing every day is I will be posting, if you still need a workbook. If you're not watching live, make sure to comment in that thread, okay? Because otherwise it's kind of hard for us to figure out who. I was sending some last night and I guess you guys got double on it. So the comments come in as the video is playing. It doesn't come in like as you guys, in order of who commented. So it's kind of hard to determine. And then I can have my assistant every day send those out based on the thread of you guys who don't have a workbook. So again, say hi as you come in. If you have and I'm not seeing your comments, I'm sorry, you guys. I don't see any comments coming in as of right now. Again, feel free to put your questions in the comments. I do go back and read through to answer questions after the presentation. I do try and keep up with it also after like tomorrow. I'll try and go through too for the replays. Okay. Yesterday I had over 100 comments on my presentation we did yesterday. So I did still make it through though to answer questions. So please feel free to ask any questions. So hopefully you guys did your vision casting from yesterday, and I'm hoping that you created a date. I hope you committed to that, and that you created a date that will really set when you're going to get this out to your staff. So just a date that you want that buy-in. It is so important to get that buy-in. So today we're going to talk about your center's culture. And then tomorrow we're going to talk about creating and leading your dream team. On Thursday, we're going to talk about your center's structure, which will include like policies and procedures. And one note on policy and procedures I've noticed, when I'm working with clients one-on-one, A lot of them think they have policies and procedures, and when they send them to me, they're really not policies and procedures. They're just an employee handbook, which is totally different than what a policy and procedure is. So we'll go into that in depth though, because that really was another huge piece to make sure that I turned that corner from just being a daycare to a preschool, you know, to like a higher end preschool. So and then on Friday, we're going to look at research-based high quality standards. And Saturday, I'm going to be hosting a Zoom meeting where all of you guys can jump on and ask me your questions. So the nice thing about the Zoom meetings is that we can actually have conversations. So instead of me just reading comments, or you guys can actually come on, ask me questions, and we can actually talk to each other. It's a little bit easier too. I can show you different things, like do some screen sharing. So that's what we'll be doing on Saturday morning for the Saturday session. That'll just be a Q&A where we can just chat and over Zoom. So you can like actually verbally ask me questions and I can see you guys too, unless you decide not to be on camera. I don't know. A lot of times Saturday morning, people don't want to be on camera, right? And Zoom right now is just so overwhelming. Both of my kids are at home doing Zoom. I'm sure a lot of you guys are going through the same thing where our children are at home. It's suddenly, everybody is suddenly going to school online. Kind of interesting. So getting into the content today, culture. So culture is a lot like a brand, right? Branding and culture can go hand in hand. And the reason when I really sat down and thought about like, which one am I going to choose, culture or brand? Because they're both extremely important. The reason I chose the culture is because the culture that you decide for your center will determine your brand. They go hand in hand, and your culture will actually result in your brand. Okay. So it's kind of, a lot of these are going to overlap. If you've listened to my previous trainings or my podcast episode, when I talk about branding, it does overlap a lot, but culture is a little bit different, and it does have a couple elements that are different. And, but both of them are something you want to be really, really intentional with, right? And I can guarantee you guys that every single one of your centers has a culture. Whether you intentionally created it or not, you have a culture. The problem is that some centers' cultures are not positive. They aren't something that you would really be proud of, right? And this is where it's really important for you to look at your center. If you're a newer center, it's great because you can intentionally create the culture that you want for your business from now until, you know, you expand to multiple centers or whatever your vision is. And if you don't, what ends up happening is your staff will end up, creating that culture. And that is something we want to avoid, okay? Because that's when things like gossip issues or a lot of call-ins and things like that can take over your center. Because if you're not really intentional about it, it will take a life of its own. So you want to make sure you're going in, and the culture of your center and your center's brand really starts with you. It's really, you know, that old saying that the buck stops here. That's really what happens with culture and brand. It's so, so important. And so you want to just sit down and think about, what feelings do you want your center to convey? So think about if there's a couple parents in the park and they're talking about your center, what kind of things do you want them to say about your center? Even if they don't attend your center, it's the reputation within your community. What are the kind of feelings you want people to feel when they're talking about your center? What kind of experience do you want your staff to have? What kind of staff do you want to have, right? I want you guys to think about Starbucks coffee versus McDonald's coffee, okay? And think about the brand that they both present, right? Both of them have a culture behind their business that is very, very intentional and very systematically set up, right? And both of them are very different business models. My husband tells me, I'm not a coffee drinker, but my husband will tell me all the time that McDonald's coffee is just as good, if not better, than Starbucks coffee. Yet the price point on Starbucks coffee is so much higher, right? Even though the quality isn't much better. And the reason for that is because of the culture, the experience, the branding behind the Starbucks model. They're charging you for that brand. They're charging you for the culture and the experience that they've produced, okay? Not so much the product, right? Because there are plenty of other products that have just as high a quality, but it's their perception that they've put into our head is the reason that we'll go pay $3 or $4 for a dollar cup of coffee, right? You can create that perception. And that's where your vision is going to come into play. Your vision is going to help create that culture if you're really intentionally putting it out there for the world, and if you have a strong buy-in from your staff and even from your families. That is what's really going to really flood this culture that we want to really present to the world, right? So you really need to think intentionally about the culture that you want in your childcare center. And you want to really just plan it out. Plan what kind of center do I want? And everything you do around your center is going to be planned around that, okay? So you've got those two elements, your vision and your culture. Whenever you're putting out curriculum, whenever you're putting out any kind of form, any letters to families, your daily sheets, everything, you are sending a message, right? And you really want to be intentional about that. One of my policies at my center, and my staff knows, is with like things like my daily sheet, my sign-in sheet, all of those different components, I will not allow photocopied sheets because I know that they just start to look just dingy. They don't look professional. They look lazy, to be honest with you. And so my staff knows if I start seeing like photocopied lines on the paper, I get pretty upset because that is not my brand. My brand is professional at all times. We look like we have our stuff together, which means you're not going to get a crooked photocopied paper, right? If you took my enrollment training, it's kind of the same thing I was telling you with enrollment. And it is the same concept where if you're giving out an enrollment packet, you're not going to give out like sloppy paperwork, right? I even make sure with my enrollment packets that I'm buying premium paper because the paper they feel is going to mean something. When I'm my own photocopy paper, I don't care. It can be cheap Walmart paper. But the paper that I'm handing out to families, especially for that first impression, is going to be high quality paper. And usually I get like even a colored papers and just make it look beautiful. So, and you guys, this isn't something that has to cost a lot. It's just something that you have to be really conscious about. It's something that you really have to be intentional about and think about everything you're putting into your parents' hands. How is that presenting your company? Okay, if you're taking your daily sheets and you're making a photocopy of a photocopy of a photocopy, there's probably lines on it. It's probably getting blurred a little. It's probably got a little crooked. So what message are you sending, right? What message are you sending to your families that are enrolled? If you're doing that for your enrollment, then think about the kind of parents that you're bringing in. So whenever somebody asks me or they tell me I'm not really attracting the kind of customer base I want, I ask them, how are you presenting your center out there? What does the world see of your center? You know, and for those of you also who want to be seen as a professional, that's the other thing I have to challenge you on is, are you presenting yourself as a professional, right? Because I can tell you guys, the people in my surroundings and in my world see me as a professional. But that's because I make sure I present myself as a professional. I have to be pretty sick or something to show up at my center in a pair of sweats. Or if I don't have my makeup done. My son knows that I won't even go to the grocery store in my town without making myself look presentable. Because I'm a business owner within my city and there's a chance that I might run into one of my customers. And I know that if I always have to look a part, right? And that is the culture I'm putting out for my center. I am always playing that owner role. My staff sees that, okay? So if I want my staff to present themselves in a way that is representative of my center, then that starts with me. I'm the one who has to represent myself first. I set the tone for that, right? And I'm setting the tone for my culture of my center. So people are going to know that my center is a professional atmosphere and we really have our stuff together, because everything I put out into the world shows that we have our stuff together, right? We plan things out well. I've told you guys that I make an annual calendar. I already have my Christmas plate on our calendar for this year. I already have the dates that my staff will be rehearsing for our Christmas play. I already have the dates that we'll mail out invitations for my Christmas play. Those are the kind of things that keep my culture, and those are the kind of things that keep my brand really solid. My staff knows that they've got their due dates, right? But that's how I've established the culture of my center, which in turn is the branding for the world, okay? So culture is really just, how do you want people to see your center? What do you want them to feel when they think of your company's name, right? And it does start with you. You guys can absolutely lead that. So make sure that's something that you're really, really being intentional about. It is so important, you guys. That is the difference between what kind of customers you're gonna attract. You know, if you have customers that come in and you don't even have a tour packet, but then they come to my center and I have this really nice tour packet put, whose center do you think they're gonna choose? Where are they gonna enroll? If you guys took my enrollment training, you guys know the process I go through. My process for enrolling a family is huge. I have up to, we actually have mailers we send out up to 6 months later. Think about that. Again, if you've taken the process, you know that for me, it starts way before they even tour my center. I want to make sure that everything I'm putting out there, the perception is just solid, right? And then when they do tour my center, well, first, when they answer my phone, my staff is trained on how to handle the telephone, right? And then my staff is trained on tours. How do they act when the parents come in the room for a tour? And that is all something I've really intentionally put together in order to make sure that that culture in my center is one of professionalism and quality. Those are the two big things for me, that professionalism and quality, right? But it's taken that work for me to make sure that my center, I'm thinking about all these things. But just, again, as we're facing this economy, if your center and my center were competing against each other, and they are touring me and touring you, and we're right around the same price point, or even if I'm $10 a week more expensive, whose center do you think they're going to enroll in? Really think about that. You guys, and that's where I can't even stress enough, you know, get your competition's information, see how they're presenting themselves, and make sure that your center isn't falling beneath that, right? If they are, and I'm not saying, you guys, that you have to have like corporate laminated, beautiful tour packets put together that you're ordering. We print ours all myself. I just make sure that they're very well worded. They're very, they entail everything most parents need to know. They're detailed and they look very professional and clean. I just print them on different colored paper. So each thing, you know, represents, like if it's our price list, that's on green paper. If it's the, you know, enrollment criteria, that might be on pink paper. So that it just looks well put together. It's just gotta be consistent too. That is another really big thing, is you gotta be consistent. People talk, you know, and if friends tend to tour centers together, you don't want this friend to get this tour packet that looks fantastic, and this friend, they're comparing, I'm like, well, I didn't get any of that, because that just gives you a bad reputation too. So really always be thinking about your reputation. How do you want people to talk about your center? How do you want them to feel? Why are they going to choose you over somebody else? Really be intentional about that. So, again, like yesterday I was talking about your legacy, right? But with your vision is going to be kind of personal, what you want to be known as. Now I want you to think in terms of what do you want your center to be known as? So when people are talking around town, what do you want people to know you as? I know for me, it's quality. I want everybody in my state to know that my center is a center of high quality standards. Okay. So that's what I know I want to be known as. And I've talked to you guys before too. That is my center's superpower. So everything we do revolves around quality, everything. And I've trained my staff to always think about that, right? The curriculum they're producing, their interactions with the children, everything is going to be like, how does this reflect our quality? Right? So everything comes back to that. That is my superpower. And that's some, a culture piece. That is our biggest value. So that's something for you to think about. Your culture of your center should revolve around your superpower. It should revolve around what sets you apart, what makes you special. And if you don't know that, you really need to figure it out. If you don't have something, now is the time to come up with that. If you're a faith-based center, it could be your faith. That's what sets you apart, your strong faith foundations, right? So everything you do, you want to revolve around that, right? If you think of a company like, for us, In-N-Out Burger, they're a faith-based company and they have Bible verses on every one of their items, right? And that's not the only thing. I mean, quality is also one of their big superpowers and fast service, but those are the kind of things you want to make sure you're consistent and that culture piece, your branding is on every piece. Everything you put out into the world is going to be reflected in your culture and your branding. So really think about that. Every decision you make for your company also should be revolving around this, revolving around your vision and your culture that you are intentionally setting up, right? So every dime you spend is going to be, how is this accomplishing my vision? How is this going to help the culture of my center? Those are the kind of things you really, really want to think about. Think about why your company does what it does, right? And I don't mean just childcare. We're all in childcare, but really why? Get to the heart of that. And a lot of the work I had you look at yesterday should get you there on that, right? Also think about what are your company values. I did write a blog post. If you guys look at my blog page under Childcare Business Professionals website, and I did write a little bit on what your values are. Your values are pretty easy to come up. Well, they can be pretty easy. They're really just a set of words. If you Google Disney's values, it's a pretty cool set of values. But, and also Apple's another one that has really good values. Really, a lot of times they're just words. Like for me, it would be integrity, quality, nurturing, honesty, right? So that really defines my center's culture. Okay. I want to be a place of high quality, a very nurturing environment, and nurturing and quality are probably hand in hand because I guess I feel like you can't have quality without nurturing in ECE. But also, we've got to be a place of high integrity. That is a very important piece to me, just honesty and integrity. So think of words like that. Just jot down some words. It's really easy. What is important to you, right? And now you think in terms of now, how can I turn that into my center's culture? So that's pretty much a good starting place for you. So I am in your homework that I gave you guys for your workbook. I do have some questions on creating your center's culture. I also did do a podcast episode on creating culture that you guys can listen to. I did not tag it in here because honestly, I forgot I had done it. And then I was looking through my podcast and found it. So I can actually attach that to the comments if you guys want to just listen to some more about culture. And really fill out this information. Again, I have on here, what are your center's values? Pretty easy. Just a list of words of things that you value. How will you be the leader your center needs you to be? Your center's culture is going to start with you, the owner, okay? I know I've talked to some directors who have detached owners who really aren't there for you. You can do this. You really don't. I know it's hard. If you're a director out there who doesn't have the help of their owner or who doesn't have a really involved owner, my heart goes out to you. Makes it very hard, but you can do this. Just think of the director you want to be, the company you want to run, and be that person, right? You can be that person who you want your company to reflect, and your team will start to follow, but it does take intentionality, and it does take intentional messaging where you really have to just put it in your messaging. You know, again, that's why I like having an employee Facebook page. I can post things in there that, you know, just messaging really quick just to help them really get my philosophy really just ingrained into themselves. So it's another reason I really like having that page. It's just another way I can really help. And directors, that's something you can do. Just constantly posting things, finding articles, doing trainings, different things like that, that makes that value that you have contagious. That's really important. Really think again on how will you get your staff to buy into this. Staff buy-in is so important. And again, this is something you can put in with that vision, right? Your vision and your culture really do go close together. You just have to really be intentional about it. How are you going to build trust? So the reason I put this in here, especially for established centers, right? You're going to be doing this transition and shift. You probably haven't been intentional about your center's culture, but now you want to try. So now you're going to have to figure out a way to intentionally shift your staff into this new thought process, right? But they're going to be skeptical. I guarantee it. I've gone through it. I know I had to shift my center over. I had to really step up and go from being a manager to being a leader. And in the beginning, they are going to doubt it. They are going to just be like, yeah, right. You know, what is she doing now? Whatever. Because this isn't something you've done before. But that doesn't mean that you can't make that switch, right? You can shift and pivot. And what it's really going to take is consistency. Right now is a good time for you to really put this stuff in place and really get that clarity in your own mind. Just really get clarity for yourself. Create your vision. Create that culture you want in your mind so you see it plain as day, right? And then you're going to have to live it. You're going to have to live it every day. And no matter how long it takes until it becomes your center's culture. Okay. And eventually your staff will get that you're in this for real and they will start to follow suit. And I've had a few staff members who had to make that transition with me. I wasn't always intentional about my culture until I really started studying business a lot more. And as I started making that shift, I did have staff that came on board. The other thing I'll tell you guys is during this time, you will lose staff, but that's okay. Your staff that goes away during this time, it is meant to be. Sometimes we have to say goodbye, right? And I do have a podcast episode that's titled When It's Time to Say Goodbye. And I do talk about when sometimes we need to let our staff just move on, right? And we need to let them go. And a lot of times when you're making these shifts, when you're going from mediocre to great, you will lose staff because there are staff members who aren't going to want to do the work. But honestly, you guys, you don't need them and you're going to be better off without them. There were some that absolutely broke my heart to lose. I love them as people. Some of my favorite people ended up leaving, but in the long run, it really was for the best for them and for me. They were able to grow in their career and they were really just able to grow themselves. And I was able to grow my center. And at the time, I didn't see how certain staff members were really holding me back because I was so attached to them. So as you're doing this shift from a manager to a leader, and as you're shifting and becoming a owner or director that has this living vision that you want to bring to life, and you're creating this culture, it is going to be rough on some staff and they are going to pull back from you. But don't be afraid. You will get the people you need. You will get the people who buy in. And we are going to talk tomorrow about how you're going to start getting those people, how you're going to start attracting them, right? And don't worry, it doesn't take a lot of money. I know it's the first thing people think is that it takes, it doesn't. So just be prepared, mentally prepare yourself. There will be those who go. And definitely listen to the episode of my podcast that talks about when it's time to say goodbye. It actually does touch a lot about this and how you can determine when it's time to let certain staff members walk away or when it's time to let them go. So it's something I've really struggled with in the past is letting them walk away when it was time. But sometimes we really need to do that. So just be ready for that. So that's what I have for you guys today. And I am sorry if there are comments, they are not coming through on my end. And so I really do apologize about that, but I'm not seeing anything on my end. So after this is over, I will go back and read through your comments, answer any questions. And for those of you who've said hi, I'm sorry I didn't say hi back, but I'm not seeing anything. And again, if you don't have a workbook, let us know. I have a couple people volunteering to help me out, which I am so thankful for. I have just been absolutely swamped the last couple days with everything going on. And again, if you have any questions, let me know. For my membership people, we are meeting in, 15 minutes. We are going to jump on our Zoom meeting. So I will see my membership ladies in about 15 minutes. I have a workbook that's a lot more in depth than this one that I've created for you guys. It just really helps you guys come up with a plan and just mapping the whole thing out. So I will see you guys in about 15 minutes. And everybody else, have a great evening and take care of yourself. I'll see you tomorrow afternoon.